Yes, thank you very much, Sarah. So I'll jump right into it. Today we have a really exciting presentation. My name is Matthew Halliday. I'm the president of Canada Silver Cobalt. And we have the highest silver grade asset in the world at the Castle East, and it's backed up by a 43-101 compliant resource. And we also have critical battery metal properties across Ontario and Quebec here in Canada. So our disclaimer, this is corporate presentation, can be downloaded from our website. So it's an interesting time here at Canada Silver Cobalt. Again, we have our silver deposit with a cobalt byproduct. Is the exceptional project here in Northern Ontario at the Galganda Castle East. And we are currently in the middle of an advanced stage exploration program. And we've drilled about 53,000 meters so far of our 60,000 meter drill program. And we will have a resource coming up in this quarter to finalize this program. We're working right now at getting a ramp underway at the Castle East, and we are completing our environmental baseline this half of the year, and we're also working on the permitting phase to get ourselves permits for the ramp exploration, as well as we have assets here in the town of Cobalt. We have the TTL facility. It's a mini mill nearby, and we will be able to produce rough doré bars there. At the same time, we are now have Koniagis Battery Metals Inc. It's a subsidiary of Canada Silver Cobalt, and this subsidiary is in preparation for putting our battery metals component of the company in and eventually having it as a spin out. So we have our new discovery at the Graal-Nercier project in Northern Quebec, and we've been drilling into massive sulfides there with high grade nickel and copper. As well as we'd be putting in the Re2Ox hydrometallurgical process there, that is an environmentally friendly hydrometallurgical process that can produce value-added products for the EV market. So the near-term catalysts, particularly here at the Castle East, we have our resource update coming up this quarter. We'll be completing our drilling of the 60,000 meters in the March of this year. We will be completing the environmental baseline study by mid-year, and we will be preparing the permitting process now, and that process will go into place until early 2023. We're getting all the preparatory work in place for a PEA, and we will have new targets being developed for additional drilling and exploration at the castle in the future. At the Nercier Graal and our projects in Quebec, the Graal property has been identified as our most prospective property. So we did a bunch of geophysical surveys at the beginning of last year. And from the results of that, we have prioritized our projects, and we've initiated drilling at the Graal, and we've already intersected massive sulfides. It's very interesting for us, and we're really excited about this, and we've taken initial readings where we had up to 2.7% nickel and up to 25% copper from the XRF results. And so we've sent these samples off to the lab, and we'll be getting results back shortly. So in Quebec, we have 15 properties. We have one in Ontario, and we have our Re2Ox technology, and that's all being consolidated into the Koniagis Battery Metal subsidiary for a potential spin out in the future. And it's everything there is looking very good. So our team, you know, there's we have a team with a really broad range of skills and a lot of depth. Myself, I'm a resource geologist. I'm the VP of exploration as well as the president. And I've spent the last 15 years developing resources here in Canada and internationally. I particularly worked for about a decade with SGS Minerals as a resource geologist there, and focusing my attentions to high-grade silver and gold, as well as creating a niche in the energy metals sphere. Afterwards, I went off to First Cobalt. I worked at First Cobalt here in the Cobalt mining camp, I got my feet wet with understanding this camp, and I fell in love with this camp. I moved here. Afterwards, I was working for Kirkland Lake Gold as senior resource geologist at their Holt Holloway complex. And I joined Canada Silver Cobalt as I was extremely excited to continue the exploration here in the cobalt mining camp and find some new silver and cobalt deposits and continue my career in the EV world. Frank Bassa, our CEO and chief metallurgist, he is one of the very first metallurgical engineers here in the cobalt mining camp. He was working for Agnico Eagle back in the 1980s, and he was, again, one of their first metallurgical engineers here. And he worked at the mill, and he has extreme depth of knowledge in the extraction of silver and of cobalt here in the cobalt mining camp. And he understands the business model that was so effective for Agnico at that time to be able to create a centralized system here in the cobalt mining camp. I'd like to mention Doug Robinson, a senior consultant, and he spent 40 years in this camp, 14 years underground. Very important to have that type of knowledge on hand. Jacques Manette, the director of the company, he's a mine consultant, worked all over the world, bringing mines to life. And I think that's important for our ramp. Diane Tukney, another board of directors. She is a First Nations, and she is also a First Nation consultant and community relations consultant. And I think it's really important to have her on board and making sure that we are putting our best foot forward when it comes to keeping all of our community relationships and agreements in good standing. I'd like to mention Claude Duplessis as well. He works for Gold Mines Geoservices, and he's our lead in the Quebec battery metals exploration side. This is the cobalt mining camp. It's a very large camp, produced over 500 million ounces of silver, about 650 million ounces of silver historically, and around 30 million pounds of cobalt. We're located in a satellite camp just in the northwest called the Gauganda camp. And this is kind of the area that we're working in, and you can see that we are surrounded by a lot of geological power. Kirkland Lake Gold, Alamos Gold, IM Gold are all kind of along this Cadillac Rideout Shear Zone. We're kind of in the heart of that, so we're in a great place to continue to develop a project. The Castle Silver Mine property is here in the Miller Lake Basin. We can kind of see in the center, there's this Miller Lake Basin, and it's a dominantly a pink dye-based sill, and that is where we've seen historic production of silver in the Gauganda camp. There's about 70 to 80 million ounces of silver produced here, dominantly from three mines, including the Castle Mine, which we own fully. And our new high-grade discovery is a kilometer and a half east of the Castle Mine, where we call it the Castle East. And we hit up to 70,000 grams per ton from our pilot hole. And we've been continuing to work on this project to date. So after we had the initial discovery, we went back and we defined a small drill program to be able to put resources onto the Castle discovery. And we did that in May of 2020. We put a 7.5 million ounces inferred at 8,582 grams per ton, which we believe is the highest silver grade resource in the world. Also is the very first 43-101 compliant resource in the cobalt mining camp. And as we continue to develop resources in the cobalt mining camp, I think that people will see a lot more of this. I think it's really important to know that as we continue to grow this resource, we have a lot of room to grow. We have about 1.5 to 2 kilometers between the Castle and the Robinson. And that ground is highly prospective. The Castle should be dipping to basically the silver mineralization dips from the Castle towards the Robinson zone. And as we get into the south of the Robinson zone, we have room to grow for a long, long time as we have a good property package that continues into the heart of the Miller Lake Basin. This is what it looks like. It's just spectacular stuff. We basically have a solid plug of silver and cobalt, and this is what we call classical cobalt style mineralization. So anyone who is fortunate enough to come and see this, this is what we really have here. There's been 100 years of mining in the cobalt mining camp. And they mined veins basically between 1 inch and about 12 inches, with the average vein width being between about 2 and 3 inches. They had these amazing grades like we have here, where, you know, in picture two, we have 70,000 grams per ton over 0.3 meters. We have this silver kind of penetrating into the wall rock. It's just spectacular stuff. So quickly, we just have a very high grade silver resource with a modest cobalt component, 0.1-0.2% cobalt byproduct. And we'll be able to produce that byproduct very cheaply, because we get all of the profit comes from the silver. This is our silver grade in relationship to the rest of the world. We took some of the higher grade silver deposits around the world, and you know, you can see that we have extremely high grade. And this is basically this is basically what you're going to see from the cobalt mining camp. I mean, this is a high grade narrow vein silver camp with a lot of deposits that have just extreme density of silver. And so, speaking of that, this is what it looks like. Again, we hit another vein, big silver vein. And so we're continuing to grow our portfolio. As we continue to grow the network of veins here at the Castle East, you know, we're continuing to find these spectacular high-grade silver intercepts. So big silver vein now is one of our newest ones. This will be going into our next resource update. And, you know, we've hit almost 9% silver with a 1.5% cobalt product there. And as we continue to develop the same methods to put resources onto our deposit, you know, we have basically hit the big silver over and over and over again. And here, if we look on the right, we have 53,000 grams per ton silver and 2.2% cobalt over 0.48 meters. So we're very happy that we're moving in the right direction to build resources. And we're moving in the right direction to continue to find new silver intercepts. So here is the section, a cross section, basically looking south, where we can see where the original Robinson vein is in the center. And as we continue to move to the east and the west, we discovered the big silver in the 17 meter zone, as well as now the 61A and B. So we're going to continue to finish our program, put out our resource update, continue our permitting and get that ramp down, and then develop fresh new targets at the castle for continued resource development and for eventual extraction. And here is a snapshot of the environmental baseline study. Everything is underway. And these are the cells that we've decided that we need to bring into advanced exploration. That's the location of our ramp. It will probably change slightly after the new resource update, as we'll have a lot more veins in there. It might be optimized a bit further, but this is the general conception that we're working on. And we would like to process at the TTL facility. So this facility is in the heart of cobalt, and we have produced 3 silver bars there as proof of concept in the end of 2019. We purchased the facility in 2020, and it is basically ready and able to be used as a grinding circuit. There's a ball mill, cone crusher, as well as a bullion furnace in the basement where we can produce rough doré bars. Like to mention that we do have a new acquisition in Kirkland Lake Gold. We have a new acquisition in Kirkland Lake. It's about 5 kilometers away from Kirkland Lake Gold's Macassa mine. So we have a large claim package here, it is off of what is called the EB Auto Fault. It goes through EB Auto Township. We call this the EB Auto Project. And now this fault is a splay off of the main Larder Lake fault. And so there's a lot of really positive spins to this project. We have multi-generational veins near surface. We have the right alteration. We have the fine-grain disseminated sulfides, as well as we have that image where this splay coming off of the main break, the EB Auto fault, has a lot of parallels to some of the other mines in the area and the splays that they have coming off of the main break. So, you know, we're very excited to take this project and continue to develop it and find more of these veins and do some grassroots type of exploration, as well as take some of the parts that we know are a little bit more advanced and get them drill ready for the end of the year. The battery metals side of the company is going full tilt. We have basically a nickel, copper, and cobalt exploration properties in Northern Ontario and Quebec. We have 15 of them in Quebec, one in Ontario. We're continuing to do exploration right now at the Nercier Grell massive sulfide formation. We have all of this together under the Koniagus Battery Metals Inc. It's a subsidiary of CCW, along with the Rituox processing technology, and we're getting ourselves ready to basically produce product for the EV market. So what is underway right now, we have again a 5,000 meter drill program, slightly expanded in the Nercier Grell project. Now this was based off of the airborne surveys that we did earlier this year. We have identified a lot of targets across Ontario and Quebec, and we built a very large property package, 39,000 hectares, and we've basically prioritized them, and the Growl is the big one. And so it has already been, we've been already drilling, and you can see that we have hit massive sulfides in the drill core. And so we're extremely happy to have detected this. This is the drill core here. We're looking at shallow lenses between 1 and 200 meters. And here we have Claude Duplessis at the drill rig for the project at Grell. So what we've done basically is we've accumulated a very large property package at the Growl. We've consolidated what we can. We have 6 kilometers of strike length, and we have some excellent XRF results from our initial drill core. That drill core has all been sent to the lab, and I expect that we'll be seeing that back in the near future. So those assays are pending, but not for too much longer. We have started compiling a lot of the historical information into this area and have discovered a lot of great new opportunity, and there remains to be a lot of opportunity here at the Growl. If we look at this map here, these are all showings in the area for nickel and copper. The red outline is the Growl property, and the dark brown is nickel, and the orange is copper. So we have this property package where we have this 6 kilometers of basic strike length of good showings. And we're next door to a phosphate mine. So we're also in the right area for developing a project.
You've got 60 seconds left, Matt.
Okay. So in basically the end of it is that, you know, all of this is kind of coming together, and we are poising ourselves to be simplifying our story. So we'll be having ourselves as the Koniagus Battery Metals. We'll take out the EV side, and then Castle Silver will remain a precious metals type company. And we're very excited to be moving forward.
Very good. That word excited, I began the introduction paraphrasing what you had announced earlier this month about the encouragement that you are experiencing, how incredible these intercepts are. But the thing is that the weather is against you. Now, I understand that in Ontario, it's a balmy minus, no, in Quebec, it's a balmy minus 12. Ontario, it's a balmy minus 7. So are shovels frozen at the moment, or is the process got to the stage where it's quite automated?
Oh no, we're going full tilt. So where we are here in Haileybury, it's minus 25 today. Really fun stuff. The car does feel that in the morning, but the ground is still good for drilling. We're not in the Arctic, so we don't have permafrost. We don't need to use salt or anything like that for drilling. As long as we have a warm water to continue drilling, then we're good to go. Again, we're all used to it here. So we get up in the morning and we continue to work through the minus 25, and we're just waiting for better, warmer days.
Okay, so you're seasoned, you're tough, you're very grizzly Adams, and you've got credentials, the pair of you. Now, you are drilling into massive sulfides. Have either of you, in your careers, experienced anything like this?
On the silver side, no. On the base metal side, no. But then again, Sarah, I'm still young, eh?
But seriously,
No, I haven't.
you might be young, but you've been around a bit. So, you're using, there's lots of hyperbole, incredible, how extremely encouraged you are. But, in terms of size and scope, you said, yes, we've got the world's largest silver deposit. But give us a bit of context. Who else, what other project out there is similar in nature?
There's no project similar in nature when it comes down to our silver cobalt story. This is the most advanced project in the cobalt mining camp, and the cobalt mining camp is unique around the world. It's just something that is special to this place. And I don't think that there's too many places that you'll find similar types of deposits. There is a small amount around the world that are in the same what we call five element style deposits, and you'll see a couple of them historically. There might have been one in France, there may be a couple in Scandinavia, and even in other side of this province. But really, for the scale, the size, and the prolific nature of these deposits in the cobalt mining camp, they're really solo. It is the cobalt mining camp is its own beast.
Okay, well, in terms of that beast, you described it as being at an advanced stage exploration project. You talked about the permitting phase for the ramp exploration. Do you envisage any problems with that permitting process, or is it relatively straightforward?
I think that it's relatively straightforward. Of course, we're living now in the time of COVID, and a lot of the government agencies are probably working from home. And that may provide a couple of small hurdles, organizing people together, organizing meetings. But when it comes to the project is pretty fresh, it's pretty clean. We basically have this six group of claims that are in the shadow of a headframe. So, there is old mines in the area, but not underneath our spot. So all we have to do is basically the proper legwork and the proper order, and it should be a fairly smooth project in terms of complexity. It's pretty simple.
Yeah,
I think
maybe
carry on.
if I may, Sarah. My apologies. Now, Sarah, we did get a permit already for going underground at the castle. And the way it works, you have to have a good relationship with the First Nations, which we do. And if you look at our board of directors, Diane Tookney is First Nations. So when we first got her on board, I think we're the first company in Canada, major or junior, that a First Nation individual on the board of directors. So we have a wonderful relationship with them. We do regular presentations with the First Nations, and it's critical and they're very supportive. It is their ground. I don't know if you're aware of it, but a lot of this ground has never been ceded. In other words, there's no treaties. And actually, they're very nice to work with. They visit us on a regular basis, and we give them 2% of our exploration budget. So it's a win-win for everybody. It benefits them, benefits us. And they've done deals like this with other companies in the areas, majors are producing, whereby they use their services in addition to getting this fee. So we're in an area whereby the First Nation we deal with, we've been dealing with them for many years. And it's a critical thing to work with them. And that simplifies your life with the environmental people. And it's always a challenge. You know, COVID has been quite a challenge for us. We didn't have any real lost days of any of our people getting sick. We kind of been operating virtually before it became popular. So we don't have an office. Matt works out of his home with his dog. You know, last time you heard the dog communicating. And of course, I work out of my home, with my wife. My kids are gone. One of them is actually in England having a wonderful time. He graduated from Oxford. So I get this, she makes more money than I do. Anyway, so that's a little bit of history there. But to really work here in Canada, you have to work with the First Nations. And so far, we're working with 5 different First Nations, and it has been a wonderful relationship.
And I think it helps that both of you are very kind, because you've both accumulated kindness credits. And I do think that that helps when, you know, the big decision makers, administrators get involved. Now, you talked, Matt, about the project being fresh and clean. And Frank, you just reminded us that you have a representative who liaises with the First Nations, which brings me to my first question from the virtual floor. And Dr. Massey is looking for reassurance. She says, nickel and cobalt are potentially toxic. There is no obvious director with responsibility for human health and safety / environmental impact. She needs reassurance. What are you doing about the potential toxicity and someone who is going to hold you to account?
Okay, now we started doing things before this ESG, is it environmental social governance, before it became popular. In other words, it's a very old camp. And the real problem in the camp is the arsenic. The camp actually has very high arsenic. Part of our V2OX process was to recover the arsenic and make it into what they call, it's a ferric arsenate, it's very stable. So in other words, when we develop the V2OX process, it's a closed process. So in other words, everything we get goes in there and it comes out. So we were told that the Americans, arsenic is one of the metals that they want. We're gonna produce it as a copper arsenate. So they use it as a wood preservative. All the other stuff, nothing actually leaves our process. You'll notice there's 2 purification stages. We're the only ones that have a purification stage in our process. We've kind of demonstrated this process. We're using SGS, our global engineering geological group. They're based out of Switzerland, and we pay a premium to use their services, but we don't do anything unless, first of all, we actually discuss it with the First Nations. First Nations is a lot more than just the environment. You have to look at their ancestral ground. We have to look at if there was any villages there, and we communicate with them. And they're worried about the animals. See, a lot of people just say, well, you know, you meet all your environmental criteria, and they'll say, well, you know, how about the animals? You know, how about the fish? And how about the beaver? How about, you know, and we address all these things. So it's a little more than, a simple toxicity of the metals. You have to listen to them. You have to understand their concerns. And you know what? There are actually real concerns. And when you look at our environmental legislation, in Canada, people think we're tough. Actually, we're far away from what, you know, what should really be done. And we should be looking at long term, not just close up and walk away. But we should look at, you know, what are we really doing? Are we really repairing the ills of, you know, historic mining? Because you come to the camp and it's really sad what they've done. In the old days, they just dumped the tailings into a lake.
Okay, That is very worthwhile. It's good to know. We are running out of time. I'll give you one extra minute because there's two questions about the share price. Trevor saying the shares have been relatively subdued since you last presented at this event, which I think was last quarter. What do you think will drive the share price upwards this year? And are we likely to see you on the junior market here in London?
Here's the problem with a share price. Our company, a lot of my older investors, and I've been told this before, and I've addressed their concerns with another company we have. You know, and we just did some presentations today. Nobody really knows what we're doing. It's a simple thing. I know we do a lot of presentations. Normally, we have a very simplified model to the company. We do only one thing. But we started this thing first for the cobalt story, and then it all of a sudden went off to a silver story. We never thought we were going to hit this. And then we try to do two things at the same time. And so that's one of the reasons we'll be separating the company. We've done that with this company. Originally, we had the silver asset in another company and got no traction. We spread it out, you know, put it into a distressed shell, and we took the share price from a penny and a half to 3 cents to 88 cents, and we gave a dividend to the other shareholders of the company. And basically, in 4 years' time, they made $16 million in profit in dividend. This gets our shareholders of the other company. So we're hopefully going to do something here like this. We're at a stage that I think we're ready to break the company up. And hopefully, you know, if the exchange permits it, they'll get a share and a warrant. And of course, it's over a 4-year time frame. I don't think the EV battery metals are going to go away. And I think silver and gold, you know, we're trying to make a silver gold play out of this company. And hopefully it's silver and gold will do what it normally does when we have a lot of inflation.
London, yes or no?
I'd like to do London. I'll tell you why, because I can keep an eye on my daughter. But I tell you, I've been well received in London. And a lot of my investors are UK-based. A very nice group of investors. And I like the way they take me to this nice little Italian restaurant. We have pasta. We drink white wine. And then they say, how much money do you need?
Stop, Frank. You always bring it round to food. It is not a culinary show. However, thank you very much for giving us so much to digest. Matt Halliday, Frank Basser, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for being the first presentation of 2022. You never disappoint.
Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.